Welcome back. We'll now start to look at the legal structure that is typical in a project financing. Such structures can look unwieldy in the beginning. Transactions are not uncommon that have more than 25 different agreements. But we'll see that they are usually easier to understand once we understand the basic reasons behind them. As before, we start by sketching the context, as this will help our understanding. In the previous videos, we have seen that a project finance, we try to achieve a number of important objectives. We ring fence, that is, separate the project from its surroundings by concentrating it in a special purpose vehicle. We stabilize the cash inflows by agreeing in an offtake agreement that the buyers will be committed to pay the SPV a pre-agreed amount for a pre-agreed term. And three, we stabilize the cash flows by agreeing fixed prices for investment contracts. We allocate as many risks as we can to other parties to further increase the predictability of the project cash flows for the SPV. The consequence of these actions is that the SPV has very stable and predictable cash flows. This is attractive for lenders and investors, and that enables the financing at the lowest possible cost. All these actions require legal agreements to be put in place. All these agreements are signed simultaneously at the time of the legal closing. We also saw earlier that we try to standardize the process as much as possible, even though projects can be very diverse in nature and in scale. This standardization makes it possible for project managers and other project specialists to move from project to project and to reuse their knowledge and experience. There's another reason to standardize the structure, the fact that people of different backgrounds need to work together seamlessly on a project. This is only possible if they can work in an organized and standardized way. So the first feature of a project legal structure is the project company, or the SPV, into which the whole project is concentrated. Because the SPV ring-fences the project, it serves as the proverbial fire door in case something goes wrong in the project or outside the project, for example, the bankruptcy of one of the stakeholders. That SPV needs to raise funding, that's a combination of debt and equity, to make the project investments possible. So there will be equity subscription agreements and project loan agreements. Thereafter, the project company has the funds to invest and it signs an EPC contract, or a turnkey agreement, for the construction of the project asset, for example, a power plant. It wants to keep that power plant in fully operating condition by signing an operation and maintenance, or O&M, agreement. If the project company is constructing an infrastructure item, it will sign a concession agreement with the government authority that is mandated to organize that infrastructure. For example, the National Roads Authority, if it's a road. This concession agreement will probably say that the project company must create the road according to a certain minimum standards and that it is to be opened by a pre-agreed date. The agreement then states that the project company is permitted to operate the road for a certain number of years, say 20 years. In that period, it may charge a toll to road users. We call such an agreement a build, operate and transfer, or BOT. Transfer here means that the road is transferred to the government after the operating term has ended. This is often for no consideration. That is possible because by then the project company will have earned back its investment plus an acceptable investment return through the toll revenues it received. In this example, the project revenues are the toll fees paid by the road users. Then there is no offtake agreement with one particular buyer. But that would be different if the project builds and operates a power plant that produces electricity. Then there is likely to be an offtake agreement with that power utility. Another way for the project company to generate revenue in a PPP project may be that the government agrees in the concession agreement to pay a fixed price for the use of the asset. For example, for the use of a road, a prison, building or a hospital. This usage payment then comes in place of the toll fees or the other project sales. If the project needs certain raw materials to be able to operate, we will need to secure the delivery and the price of those. We do that in an input supply agreement, for example, gas in a power plant. Here we have the basic ingredients of a project finance structure. The concentration of all project documents in the SPV has an added benefit. It creates a clear governance structure where the role and responsibility of each stakeholder is clearly defined beforehand. It creates the closest it can to an SPV functioning on an autopilot. Once the transaction is closed and all the agreements are signed, each party goes to its predefined task. Of course, it's unrealistic to assume that it would be entirely possible to stay on autopilot. Unexpected events always happen. But through the predefined responsibilities and tried and tested dispute resolution mechanisms, we try to pre-allocate the risks of these unexpected events to the parties that are best able to handle them. And we try to encourage that all parties are motivated to work towards an early solution. We saw that all agreements are signed simultaneously, at the same time, at the legal closing of the transaction. All agreements then form part of a transaction Bible. The transaction Bible consists of the following three parts. There's the financing documents, the agreements that relate to the project loans. The security documents, this is the range of documents that grant certain security rights to the lenders. The security rights are typically a pledge on the SPV shares, on the bank accounts of the SPV, and on project receivables like its revenues. The lenders can call in these securities if the project company should default on its loans. The value they bring then helps to repay a part of the project loans that are outstanding. The project documents are the third part, and these are the agreements that have been put in place to stabilize the project cash flows. They include the offtake agreement, the input supply agreement, and the EPC agreements. We discussed some of these agreements before. Finally, the whole transaction Bible is brought together in a due diligence report that is prepared by the transaction legal advisor. This report describes the various agreements, their purpose in the transaction, and the anticipated governance and risk management situation that has been created. This legal due diligence report is very useful to get the overview of all the planning that has gone into the transaction. This now gives us an overview of the legal structure and the reason it's been developed. In the next video, we'll look more closely at the project loan agreement, which contains some very useful features. Thanks for listening for now.